Global Development Network, which aims to help economists in developing countries help policymakers, holds its annual meeting in Manila this week. The focus, inclusive growth, the social buzzword of our times, and social protection. The Philippines is an ideal place to talk about these as the government struggles to spread the benefits of fast growth and adopts a social protection program that has its roots in South America, the Pantawid Pamilya Program. The Philippine Institute of Development Studies has helped organize the conference, and with us tonight is PIDS President Josef Yap. Dr. Yap, thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
You know, since last week, this is a perfect time, because since last week we've been talking about, for example, the unemployment figures.
Yes.
And how those don't jive with the very fast economic growth. What's the Philippines' record in terms of making growth more inclusive, sharing that fast growth with more people?
Well, if you compare it to other developing countries, especially to those in Southeast Asia, we are lagging behind in terms of reducing poverty. So that's an indicator that our economic growth is not inclusive.
What do you think spells the difference between those countries and us? What makes them more inclusive? Their economy is more inclusive than ours.
That might take a whole day to answer, but to put it succinctly, we were not able to develop our manufacturing sector, especially if you compare the record of Thailand and Malaysia to that of the Philippines. And because the manufacturing sector is able to give high productivity jobs, high paying jobs, even for high school graduates, and those kinds of jobs will generally make growth more inclusive in the sense that you're able to address the poverty situation.
Well, what the economists keep on pointing out is that we have a lot of service jobs, and in fact that grew a lot in the last in that last period. But many people or many of their citizens can't get those service jobs because it requires a higher level of education.
Yeah, especially the higher paying service jobs, that's true, and the call centers, other BPO type industries, they do require this college degree. That cannot be, the service sector cannot be relied on, although admittedly it did provide a boost to the economy, but you cannot rely on the service sector for sustained and high economic growth.
The government is very aware of that by now, right? That they need to boost the manufacturing sector.
I believe so. If you see the pronouncements from DTI, and recently President Aquino himself has supported the industrialization of the Philippines.
And in fact, you at PIDS have worked with the DTI and the BOI in terms of a roadmap for the manufacturing sector.
Yes, yes.
Now, I think I've heard everything about all the complaints about the manufacturing sector. What has your research revealed that is surprising to you?
As you mentioned, there's the standard factors like infrastructure. But when we listened to the presentations of all these roadmaps, what we observed is that there are coordination problems among certain clusters of industries. My favorite example is copper manufacturing and copper mining. The copper mining sector, they export all their produce output. And then the copper manufacturing, they import all their
raw material.
So there's some sort of gap between these two sectors. So such coordination problems, if resolved, can give a boost to the manufacturing sector.
If we can connect those two, it means more jobs and more income for the country.
Yes.
You also had an example when it comes to motor vehicle parts.
Yes. The motor vehicle industry and motor vehicle parts. The motor vehicle parts industry, they are very reluctant to invest more, expand their production, because they're not assured of a market from the motor vehicle industry.
And in fact, the problem there is some manufacturing plants here have transferred abroad or have closed down, and we just import the cars from Thailand, for example.
Yes.
So how do you address that problem?
One is they want some level of assurance that the quality from these motor vehicle parts manufacturers reach a certain standard.
So the car makers want an assurance from the parts makers as well.
Yeah. So there's a coordination problem also in that particular aspect. And the government can play a role, some sort of guarantor. I'm using that term rather loosely. But there are coordination problems, investment coordination, that government can play a role of an arbiter, and it can actually make the manufacturing more integrated. Okay, and then more jobs, as you mentioned, more jobs, more value added.
Now, one place where the Philippines has had some success over the last 5 years is its Pantawid Pamilya program. This is something it's picked up from Latin America or South America.
Yeah.
How effective has it been here?
There are some preliminary studies by my colleague, for example, Celan Reyes has done some studies. The evidence is that it has increased enrollment rate in some grade levels, but that's still preliminary. I understand the World Bank also did a study, and I haven't seen the results yet, but they're also encouraging. The results, I understand, are encouraging.
And there's a debate, I think, in the government now about whether to extend the Pantawid Pamilya program. Right now, it guarantees a certain stipend to families who keep their kids in school through grade 7.
Yes.
There's a debate now whether we're going to extend that to high school. My question is, why would anyone object to that?
Well, one consideration, of course, is the budget. Do we have enough funds to extend the program up to high school?
The government keeps on underspending anyway in other sectors.
But I think that's just temporary. Once the economy picks up, then government has to sustain this recovery by spending more on infrastructure. So if you are a policymaker and you have these limited funds, so do you extend the conditional cash transfer program, or do you spend it on infrastructure or even other aspects of education and health? So these are decisions that have to be weighed carefully, studied carefully. But if you look at the conditional cash transfer program, ideally it has to be extended until high school, because that's the employable age, high school. Okay, so if you just stop at grade 7 and then they drop out of school, then these students will not be employable.
And when the policymakers come to making that decision, it's economists like you or PIDS which should help them do that cost-benefit analysis, right?
Evidence-based policy. Not policy-based evidence.
In terms of the latest work that PIDS has done, which is really interesting, what stands out for you there?
Well, we've done in support of other government agencies. My colleague Linda Medalia helped study, do feasibility studies for the proposed Philippines-EU free trade agreement. So we have already submitted that to DTI. My other colleague, Royal Briones, has questioned the wisdom of this food self-sufficiency by 2013. His analysis shows it's too costly, it's not optimal. Then we've done studies on higher education, what would be the more effective structure of student financial assistance. So those kinds of studies we've been doing in the past few years.
Now, you have 400 economists and researchers coming here. I'm sure they're here by now for this three-day conference that starts tomorrow. What discussions are you really looking forward to there?
Yeah. By the way, the GDN emphasizes that it's a multidisciplinary it adopts a multidisciplinary approach,
so
they're
not
just economics.
Okay.
They pride themselves in approaching development from a multidisciplinary angle. We hope to learn from the experience of other countries in their implementation of conditional cash transfer programs, in their promotion of inclusive growth. There are many success stories where the Philippines can learn from, and in other aspects, they can also learn from the Philippines.
And you have this three-day conference, and aside from the PPP programs or the conditional cash transfer programs, what else would be interesting to listen to there?
There are studies based on apart from social protection, the study on inequality, that's important, because East Asia has been experiencing rising inequality, in the case of the Philippines, it's not rising inequality, it's persistent inequality in the Philippines.
Yeah. Amid rising growth.
Amid rising growth.
So very, very difficult conundrum to resolve.
Yeah, yeah. And then that's because studies have shown clearly that inequality adversely affects long-term economic growth.
Okay, we look forward to those discussions. Dr. Yap, thank you very much.
Thank you very much for having me.